Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. We have consideration of whether to take items three and four in private. Item three is consideration of the evidence we will hear under item two. And item four is consideration of our work programme. Do we agree to take these items in private?
Agreed.
We are agreed. So we move straight on to agenda item two, which is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work, Energy on the Scottish Government's priorities relevant to the committee's remit. Now, this is a very wide-ranging session to help the committee understand what the recently appointed Cabinet Secretary's priorities will be in the coming months and over the remainder of this parliamentary session. Our discussion will focus on commitments made in the recently announced programme for government and on energy policy and government investments, two main areas in which the Cabinet Secretary's responsibility intersect with the committee's remit. I'm therefore pleased to welcome Neil Gray, the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing, Economy, Fair Work and Energy, Kirsty Burge, the Director of Energy and Climate Change, Vicky Halliday, the Head of Governance and Assurance Unit for the Strategic Commercial Assets, and Nick Young, the Head of Industrial Decarbonisation and CCUS of the Scottish Government. Thank you for attending this morning. Cabinet Secretary, I believe you want to make a brief opening statement. Cabinet Secretary.
I note the emphasis, Convener, and I appreciate that. Thank you. Good morning, colleagues, and thank you for inviting me to committee this morning. As we all recognise, we're at a pivotal point in our energy transition, and although Scotland has made excellent strides along the path to net zero, there is still much to do. We need to realise our enormous renewables potential, including in hydrogen and offshore wind, and we know that our electricity demand will increase as we increasingly decarbonise the economy. So to achieve a net zero energy system that can support that wider decarbonisation, we need both increasing amounts of clean energy generation and we need our electricity networks to be fit for the net zero future as well. We need significant investment in our electricity networks to reduce constraint costs and to ensure the green power is available where it is needed. The UK appointed Independent Electricity Network Commissioner Nick Windsor recently set out his recommendations on accelerating the delivery of network infrastructure, and we look forward to working with the UK Government colleagues and wider stakeholders on considering and actioning those recommendations. Since my last appearance in May, we have also had welcome confirmation from the UK Government that Acorn is best placed to deliver Track 2 CCUS objectives. This is very good news, but as of yet, the UK Government have not published any timescales or further details for the next steps of this project. This should happen as a matter of urgency. It's not just myself or the Scottish Government saying that. That is also an ask of industry. It is vital that the UK Government moves at pace on Acorn, not just to provide certainty for the industry, but also to ensure that the project can make a massive contribution to reducing our carbon emissions as quickly as possible. Recent events have demonstrated that we have no time to waste and that we must accelerate our transition to net zero whilst also ensuring maximum economic benefits for Scotland. I look forward to taking your questions, Convener. I hope that was pithy enough for you.
I would just say they're not all going to be my questions, but I do hope you've had a chance, Cabinet Secretary, to read the committee's report that was published this morning on electricity infrastructure. I believe that was an important report, and I'm sure you'll get some questions on it. And the first question will come from Ash Regan. Ash.
Good morning to the panel. Yes, I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will be well aware of the committee's recent report, which I think was timely and also an important look at the issues around that. So I think the committee would be interested to know if the Cabinet Secretary agrees that a new approach is needed, both for funding and also for developing grid capacity, and that it should anticipate future need rather than react to the current need. And if so, what can the Scottish Government do to improve the situation on that topic?
I thank Ash Regan, for that question. I note her emphasis on recent. It was incredibly recent, the publication of the report this morning, and it is incredibly important, as both the convener and Ash Regan have commented, and I very much welcome the work that has been put in by the committee to produce that report. It's very helpful, not least for government to be able to continue to make the case to the UK government and Ofgem and the systems operator around ensuring that investment is coming forward. It's obviously not a Scottish government responsibility, but we know that grid infrastructure is one of the major potential barriers to us being able to realise our net zero objectives and being able to realise the potential that we have for renewable energy, both offshore and onshore. And so I was actually at SSE at their headquarters in Perth yesterday and been able to see both their transmission and distribution network grid in front of me. You could see, you know, how complex that is and how much is still going to be required to be done. And I think your report is helpful in that regard. In terms of funding and in terms of a new approach, I think there's a couple of things that we need to do. I think your report rightly highlights the fact that we need to be taking people with us. Now, where that responsibility lies, because obviously this is, you know, the grid infrastructure is a UK government responsibility rather than the Scottish government, but obviously it has major implications on devolved policy. Then obviously we'll be looking to work with the UK government on Ofgem and the systems operator to ensure that we are giving people as much information as possible about what is going to be required. There's also, I think, an ask of industry to ensure that there is as much information coming forward there as well. We had, as I say, had conversations with SSE about this yesterday and how we can make sure that we're taking communities with us on that journey, because clearly there's going to need to be quite a substantial investment in particularly transmission infrastructure to ensure that we're taking full advantage. And those conversations are ongoing, but obviously your report was published this morning. I haven't had an opportunity to fully digest all aspects of it, but we'll certainly interact with it and respond to it in due course.
Thank you. The planning system was something that came up repeatedly when we were looking into this. And I think we would all agree that we don't want that to be a blocker onto our net zero ambitions. So again, I think a step change is needed there, perhaps in the resources for planning, perhaps in the way that planning works, the practices that are used there. So do you have a view on anything that the Scottish Government could do to perhaps create some level of improvement in that system?
I would agree that we need to make sure that where we have a responsibility, we are giving as much certainty as possible to industry, whilst also making sure that we maintain our high standards of consenting. We're obviously due to publish soon our onshore wind sector deal, which touches on these issues. We've obviously, in the programme for government, set out that we are looking to half the consenting time for onshore wind, and we're looking to reduce as far as what we possibly can, although it's at an earlier stage, the consenting times for offshore wind as well. And obviously, part of that will mean interactions with local government around ensuring that they are appropriately resourced, both in terms of funding but also in terms of people, to ensure that, and guidance that we can provide them to ensure that we are providing as much certainty as possible, as I say, whilst also maintaining high standards. But I would point you to the upcoming onshore wind sector deal, which will give us more information around how that's going to be done in collaboration with industry.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Just before we leave this, Cabinet Secretary, SSE networks and Scottish Power networks tend to plan 5 years ahead and consult on transmission lines, which means that communities are being faced with a 5-year plan, when realistically to reach our net zero is probably a 15-year plan. So where there may be one transmission or distribution network suggested, it might be that there might be 3 or 4 that are needed to reach our net zero. Do you not requirements? Do you not think SSEN and SPN would be better served by laying out a spatial plan for the medium term on the entire requirements for distribution, rather than doing one line at a time, which tends to confuse and annoy communities five times when perhaps once might be better?
I think, as I said earlier, convener, I think making sure we take communities with us as far as we possibly can is incredibly important. So where we have energy generation infrastructure going in, we have a very clear and high bar of expectation in terms of community benefit, and I'm keen that we are as creative as possible and making sure that that community benefit goes as far as possible in terms of making sure that there is economic development opportunities but also social infrastructure that's potentially coming through from that. And I hope that we can get to a place very soon where that is possible with transmission infrastructure as well, to ensure that there is demonstrable community benefit can be realised from those developments. And we've also got to take into account the incredible economic opportunity that comes from the substantial investment in our grid infrastructure that's going to be required. It's a substantial number of jobs that are going to be required to build this infrastructure. And again, we want to make sure that as much of that as possible, similar to the strategy that we're taking for our energy generation, that we have a supply chain based here in Scotland that's to ensure there's maximum economic benefit. But to answer your point directly in terms of whether we can ask industry to do more to provide as much information as early as possible, obviously we do that, and industry has you're right, are pretty well aware of what is going to be required, and trying to get that more into the public consciousness and have a greater understanding of why this is required is going to be incredibly important. The majority of this infrastructure will be required in order to ensure that we can realise our ScotWind potential and take the huge energy potential that is lying particularly off the north coast down south. We need to make sure that, as I say, we take communities with us on that journey.
I welcome your call for honesty from the industry about the true demands of what we need to get to net zero.
Transparency, I think I...
Okay, I welcome your transparency and I would echo it by a call to be honest about what's really needed, because once we're honest, then the public can fully understand the cost. Mark, you have some questions.
Yeah, thanks. I wanted just to ask you a bit more about the aspiration to halve the determination time for electricity generating stations. Is there anything more to say on that at this point, or will the detail of that, I think you mentioned guidance for local authorities, will that all be published as part of the onshore wind sector deal? Or?
Yes, the latter. We have obviously been engaged for some considerable time with industry around the onshore wind sector deal. Since I've come to office, one of the clearest areas of action that industry is looking for us to help to unlock. One is grid infrastructure. That is one of the major barriers that we have to be able to unlock our energy potential, and ensuring that there is as much certainty as possible. They're not necessarily looking for speed. Speed isn't the only factor, but certainty, giving them as much certainty as possible, which is where interactions with the 1989 Act are out with our control, make it more challenging. As soon as a public inquiry is triggered, then that adds a year onto the time that comes with that process. But the detail in terms of how we will get to that PFG commitment, it will be published in the onshore sector deal. Okay. And it's not just what we will do for industry, but in the sector deal there is also action there that's required of industry for government and for the general public as well.
Yeah, it's a new social contract, I think.
Yeah.
So then just thinking about infrastructure, and you mentioned the 1989 Act. I mean, I think the Windsor report highlighted how there needs to perhaps be some greater alignment across the UK in terms of consenting processes. Is it possible for us to make progress on that in Scotland without further devolution of powers under the 89 Act, or are there reforms, particularly around infrastructure consenting, which we can bash on with?
It's certainly not possible to take away from the potential for a public inquiry which adds the year onto the process without the devolution of those powers. And that's an important aspect of ensuring that, you know, people are able to have their say on these projects. But for us to be able to make, you know, full and meaningful progress, you're right, there is a need for interaction with the UK government, and I think particularly on onshore wind, I think it would be an understatement to say that we're on different pages around the importance of that particular element of renewable energy, as they are, as we saw from AR5 just this week on offshore wind as well. So we'll continue to interact and engage as best we can with the UK government and try to make sure that there is as much alignment as possible and that they are doing their share of providing as much certainty as possible, because that's not just an ask of the Scottish government in terms of consenting, it's also an ask of the UK government for the areas that they have responsibility for as well.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of streamlining the consenting process then for offshore wind, are there changes that could and should be made there to make things simpler?
Yeah, it's a programme for government commitment that we're looking to make sure we provide as much information and guidance as possible to local authorities to streamline and provide as much certainty as possible for offshore wind as well. Obviously, experience is at a different stage as what it is for onshore. The industry is at a different place in terms of maturity. So there's still learning to be done in terms of the competing demands on the natural environment and providing as much information as possible. But bless you. But we're looking to do what we can to provide as much guidance and certainty as we can to our planning authorities to ensure that the consenting regime that we have responsibility for is as efficient as possible.
Okay. And then switching then to hydrogen, so looking at potential for green hydrogen. I met with a hydrogen developer recently who talked about not just hard to abate sectors but hard to abate places. And it got me thinking about the green industrial strategy and whether that's going to become more place specific in terms of identifying where those potential uses are of hydrogen going forwards, how we're going to get industrial decarbonisation in key sites, and how much kind of specificity we're going to have from the industrial strategy that could perhaps help to build that certainty for investment? Or will it be kind of broader aspirations around, green hydrogen is important, great potential, not quite drilled down into where, when, and how?
No, I'm keen that the green industrial strategy is as helpful as possible at maximising the economic opportunities that we have with our massive renewable energy potential. Green hydrogen is one element of that and has the potential, depending on where we choose to go, to actually reduce the need for some of the transmission infrastructure that the convener was talking about, because it's essentially an additional opportunity for energy storage. But we need to decide what is going to be the best use and provide the maximum output from using hydrogen as an opportunity. But certainly in terms of industrial decarbonisation, you'll be well familiar with some of the plans that are there from certain parts of industry to use hydrogen as a way of reducing carbon emissions in their processes. And that's why it's so important, particularly on the CCUS front, that we see a determination from the UK government of which sites, which emitters are actually going to be part of that process, so that there is an investable proposition for those industry colleagues as quickly as possible. And for us, not just in Scotland, to meet our 2030 and 2045 targets, but for the UK to be able to meet their targets, that industrial decarbonisation is going to be absolutely critical, and CCUS is going to play a very important role in that process.
Yeah, but green hydrogen as well, which wouldn't require CCUS.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Final question is just around, other sectors, which perhaps aren't as kind of highlighted as much as some would like in the draft energy strategy. So, solar, tidal, wave energy, battery. What's your sense about whether we've got the right balance of targets and market signals for each of these sectors at the moment? I mean, I'm not going to say that they're all identical to onshore wind. There are different stages of development and closeness to market. But what's your sense of what kind of drivers and targets are needed? So could we start with solar and then go on to tidal, wave, battery?
Yeah, so on all of these areas, without being specific, obviously they're all going to be moving at a different pace. And on solar, you know, I think we're working on whether or not there is a target that could be brought, whether or not that is the appropriate way to try to drive development. On all of these elements, what was positive from AR5 was seeing marine energy come through, very on small scale, but it was progress, and that just highlights where there is support that could be provided. In this case, through the UK government's Contract for Difference, can make a real difference in actually helping to drive that development. Mm. So we're mindful of that and obviously look to do what we can, both in terms of targets, but also in terms of support, to ensure that we are delivering as best we can on the potential that we have.
Yeah. Is there a trade-off between technologies? I mean, is there a view within government that, you know, if we invest too much in grid infrastructure required for solar or even allow batteries to connect to the grid, it will hoover up the available infrastructure, transmission infrastructure for onshore wind and other technologies? Is there a point here where, you know, we've just got a limit to the transmission infrastructure that we've got and we have to prioritise certain technologies over others?
Well, before we get to infrastructure, there's obviously a limitation on what we can do based on having a fixed budget and a very challenging public finance landscape. But no, I think we need as wide as possible an energy mix, not least because they play different roles. We know that tidal is incredibly predictable, provides good, certain energy. Similarly, pumped hydro storage gives you baseload capacity when the wind isn't blowing or the sun isn't shining. And we know already that onshore and offshore wind, the wind is the cheapest form of renewable energy and is already providing a huge amount of capacity for the grid already. So, you know, I think on all areas, and as I've already said, hydrogen has the potential for us as a storage, but also to help to decarbonise other elements of the economy. So I think we need as wide as possible a mix. And that's the way. That is what we're looking to try to achieve. Some of that is at different stages. Some of that we're requiring different levels of support, both in terms of funding, but also in terms of ensuring we have certainty of consenting, but also on transmission and the grid infrastructure upgrades to ensure that they continue to be an investable proposition.
Okay.
Thank you. Thanks. Mark. Douglas, I think you've got some questions next.
Thanks, Convener. Questions around carbon capture, like yourself, Cabinet Secretary. I was delighted that the Acorn project was put on the track to a process. Really, really good news. Question really is, how is the Scottish Government and the UK Government working together to make sure that we maximise the whole potential of the Scottish cluster?
I appreciate Mr. Lumsden's question. Obviously, I am pleased that we've taken another step forward, but it is one step, and I think Mr. Lumsden would accept that fact, that until we have further clarity around which emitters are going to be included and a timescale, it makes it difficult for progress, full progress to be made. We do interact with the UK government. There's been a number of meetings at official level as well as at ministerial level around this, and we're, as you'd expect, as I hope you'd support, we're trying to push UK colleagues to go as fast as possible to ensure that these decisions are taken to give certainty and also to help unlock the Scottish Government funding, because we cannot spend that £80 million until we know which emitters are going to be included, we know where we're going to be able to add maximum value. So we want to see the UK Government go much faster. Industry does as well. It's a very strong call from industry, and they're clear that further delay absolutely risks our ability in Scotland, but also the UK government's ability to reach our net zero targets, because carbon capture, as Mr. Lumsden will be aware, plays an incredibly important role in that.
So has there been any sort of timetable set yet, or is that work still
No,
ongoing?
We've had no further information other than what you've seen publicly available, Mr. Lumsden.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned the £80 million that the Scottish Government had in their budget and then removed again. So you seem to suggest that money was going to go back in? Is that a commitment?
The £80 million is there. You know, it's there for and is committed to carbon capture when the decision is taken, when we know where we're going to be able to add the greatest value. That can only happen when there is certainty around which emitters are going to be included in that project.
Cabinet Secretary, you say it's there, but it was actually removed from the budget, wasn't it? It was included in a budget and then removed again. Is that not correct?
I can give Mr. Lumsden absolute confidence that when we are in a position to have certainty around the timescale and around which emitters are going to be included, the funding that we have committed to will be realised.
Yeah, I'm just slightly confused about this £80 million, because when you committed it initially, ACORN wasn't even given approval. So we're actually in a better state now than when you actually first put it in your budget. So when you put it in your budget initially, that £80 million, what was it envisaged for, and what was the scope of that £80 million? How was it going to be spent?
Hoping that it would help move the UK government on a little bit faster in the process, and to ensure that they are able to realise the industry's call to take decisions as quickly as possible. I don't think we're at cross purposes here, convener. Mr. Lumsden and I, we both want to see carbon capture happen. We want to see it happen yesterday. The challenge that we've got is that we want to commit this funding to ensure that we are playing our part in supporting the industry. However, until we get to the point that we have certainty around which emitters are included and the timescales, we cannot spend that money. We need to ensure that there is that certainty. So I don't think we're at any cross purposes here. I think we're both in the same area, and when that information is available, we will be in a position to spend it. But it's absolutely crucial that the UK government now takes that action.
No, I think we do both agree, but I'm confused that you had £80 million in your budget. So, you know, can you give us clarity what that was for, and then why it was removed? Because we're actually in a better place now than we were when that money was initially put into the budget.
As I've said, convener, that money will be available when we have the information around the emitters that are going to be included and when that process is going to be concluded. At this stage, we don't have that information. We cannot spend that money. When we have that information, we will be spending that money. I can't be any clearer than that, I don't think, convener.
I don't want to flog it too much, but so in terms of that item, what do you think it would be spent on? Are we talking about sort of transmission network for carbon, or is it to help businesses? What was your initial thoughts of what that £80 million would be used for?
As I've said, when we have certainty around which emitters are going to be included and what the UK government is going to fund, we will be using that £80 million to add maximum value to those that are involved, depending on what is set out by the UK government. That is why, as I've said repeatedly, it is so important that the UK government sets out which emitters are going to be included and what they are going to fund. Until we know that, it's going to be impossible for us to be able to add value, because there is nothing to add to as yet. That is why both ourselves and industry are looking for the UK government to move much faster. The longer that there is a delay, the less likely it is that we're able to meet our targets, that we're able to see the industrial decarbonisation that we all want to see and we have to see in order for us to meet our net zero objectives. And that is why I call on the UK government again to move much faster. And I do that through engagement publicly and privately, as do my officials.
I'll move on from that question, convener, because don't seem to be getting an answer on what that £80 million would have been used for. So can the Cabinet Secretary provide an update on the Just Transition Plan for the energy sector and the timing of the draft plans for agricultural, land use, building and construction and transport sectors? Because we had a debate last week and we heard, especially around the agricultural sector, how much they are screaming out for some sort of guidance. So can you give us an update on that, please?
So our energy strategy, and obviously we need to take this in order, our energy strategy and Just Transition Plan, the consultation closed earlier this year. It had substantial feedback to it. Those consultation responses are being considered, and we're hoping to come forward with a response as soon as we possibly can, in order to make sure that that part of our programme is realised, and we will move as quickly as we can on a sector-by-sector basis thereafter. You want?
I can maybe come in. I mean, we published the draft discussion papers that feed into the sectoral plan. So we're looking to publish them around late 2023-2024. I suppose the thing I would add to that is it's not all you publish the plan and then nothing happens before that. These, both the discussion papers and the plans, were developed in close collaboration with interested parties, obviously farmers and other people who use the land as part of that.
So by the end of the year, our farmers should have some sort of guidance of the direction of travel and where they need to be working on, really.
Would that be fair? I said late 2023, so early 2024. And I go back to the point that there's ongoing discussion with farmers and others. Obviously, we've got the bill coming through, I believe. So that is ongoing, and absolutely the Just Transition Plan in agriculture will support that. And we've also, of course, got our climate change plan, which will set out what we will need to do, which we will then draft, which will set out what we need to do in relation to emission reductions in the agricultural sector.
But to give Mr. Lumsden some confidence, I'm very well aware of the need for more information, particularly for those in agriculture and food production. I had a roundtable session in the south of Scotland, organised by South Scotland Enterprise, in the summer as part of my summer tour, and there is a keenness for those who work the land, those who generate income from it, to be doing the right thing. Some of them are already looking to decarbonise their operations, have already taken big strides to do so, but you're right, they're looking for information. I'm very well aware of that, I'm cognizant of that, as Mary Gujon is, and we'll do what we can, as Kirsty has said, to provide as much information as we can, as quickly as we can.
And that's good to hear, Camilla, because I think we've all been invited to farm visits over the summer, and there is a lot of frustration, so it's good to hear that is going to be prioritised going forward. Obviously, we have the Scottish Industrial Energy Transformation Fund, there's the Energy Transition Fund, and the Emerging Energy Technologies Fund. Can you give us a bit more information of how these funds are going to be evaluated and what time frame you expect sort of results from these funds to be coming through?
So there's constant evaluation on all of our funding streams across government, and we'll ensure that we continue to consider how well they're performing, to ensure that we are targeting the, as I've already commented, our limited resource in a way that adds maximum value to our enterprises that are looking to come forward with decarbonisation measures, and ensure that we're providing as much support as we can to industry, because this isn't just going to be one. Mr. Lumsden's already referenced a number of sectors. This isn't just going to be one element of the economy that's going to be doing the heavy lifting on us reaching net zero. It's not just for energy generation, and it's not going to be just for heat and buildings, but there's going to be a raft of areas that all of us are going to have to ensure that we are playing our part in making sure that we're decarbonising so that we can reach net zero by 2045.
So in terms of the timeframes for these funds, what are you going to be looking at for the reduction in output?
Sorry, forgive
me. Output and emissions.
Well, obviously, our target is there in 2045. We've also got 2030 targets as well. So all of the funds that we put forward that Mr. Lumsden has listed are about ensuring that we are taking steps in different parts of the economy for us to be able to reach those ultimate targets. Some of that is about trying to inspire good behaviour. Some of that is about supporting people to be able to take very difficult but necessary decisions around changing the way that they do their operations. But all is geared up for ensuring that we reach 2045.
Mm-hmm. But you'll be evaluating these funds and not wait until 2045 before you look at it, just to try and see how we're getting the best bang for our buck, really, in terms of these funds.
Bring in Nick and then...
Hi there. Yeah, happy to come in on that one. If I use the SIETF as an example, which is about encouraging industry to invest in energy efficiencies and decarbonisation processes, we are just about to issue the third call for that for applicants. The first two calls have been thoroughly evaluated by our client engineer and expert consultants. Those evaluations then play into the third call, and we're going through that process just now. It's an ongoing evaluation process, and the emissions reductions, energy savings are evaluated all through the due diligence process and then through the actual deployment phase as well.
Okay, thank you. Last question I had was the...
I'll just come in a bit. So these funds are, they're absolutely targeted at reducing emissions, but they're also targeted at ensuring that we have a just transition, so support people through the transition, through skills, for example. So we do quite a lot of that in the Just Transition Fund, and also capitalise on our economic opportunities. So the Emerging Energy Technology Fund that we've been talking about, which covers carbon capture and storage and hydrogen, is absolutely targeted at creating these opportunities where Scotland can be on the front foot to really A, decarbonise, but B, create the jobs and the GVA of the future.
Absolutely. Okay. Last question I had was the programme for government sets out that the Scottish Government will work with industry to create energy transition opportunities at major industrial sites in Scotland. So how is the Scottish Government going to support SMEs in reducing their environmental impact?
Well, we've already set out some of the funds that are supporting that, and also the importance that carbon capture will play there as well as ensuring that there are in sectors within the industry that are going through a decarbonisation process. So I'm thinking of the likes of Musselburgh as well as Grangemouth, to ensure that there is a continued progress being made in those areas as well. But the funds that Mr Lumsden has raised, that Nick and Kirsty have given more information on, are our areas of key focus.
And can I just follow up in terms of SNP, how big a role is SNP going to have in helping our SMEs?
Scottish National Investment Bank, it's a strange acronym which some people watching may not necessarily pick up on. Sorry, I'm sure everyone here knew that.
Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Convener. I think it's important that I think you're right, Convener, speaking with as much clarity for people as possible. Obviously, the Scottish National Investment Bank has a key role to play in us reaching net zero. They are obviously independent of government, but they've been tasked with the goal. One of their areas of priority is around net zero and ensuring that the investments that they make support us in that journey. They've got a resource there to utilise and to ensure that they are supporting projects that can help us in our energy transition and do so in a just way. I engage regularly with SNIB to ensure that they are updating me on progress, updating me on the work that they're doing. They've also been along at a number of events where they have supported organisations already. And obviously their investment proposition is going to be important, as is private capital as well, because we know that it's not going to be possible for public finance alone to be able to help us in this journey. We're not going to be able to realise our renewable energy potential nor our decarbonisation responsibilities without the support of private capital. Ensuring that continues to be an investable proposition is going to be part of my responsibility alongside other colleagues within government. And we continue to engage with the likes of SNIB as well as the First Minister's investor panel to ensure that we are doing everything we can to make sure that our energy, our decarbonisation plans are all as attractive as possible, to ensure that we can get maximum response and make sure that we get to our 2045 targets.
So would you say that...
Mr. Lumsden, you said that was your last question two questions ago, and you may get in trouble with the rest of the committee. So I may come back to you at the end, if I may. And just for clarity, you did mention farming in your questions, and so there's no dubiety. I actually do have a share in a family farming partnership, which is declared and on the record. And also, as part of that family farming partnership, there are transmission lines that go over the farm. Nothing unusual there, but I asked a question on transmission lines, so people should be aware, and I hope that's clarified.
Above board, convener. Always best to keep us all above board, convener.
Absolutely. And Monica's now going to come in with a hard-hitting question for you, Cabinet Secretary.
No pressure then. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your officials. Just a brief set of questions for now. I think I've got more later on, but just wanted to pick up on new oil and gas. I think it's fair to say that the Scottish and UK governments hold different positions on the continued exploration of the North Sea, certainly in the medium term. So with that in mind, how can the two governments ensure that while holding these policy differences, the two governments can work effectively to give maximum certainty to business and communities during what is quite an uncertain transition period?
So I think Ms Lennon's initial proposition is absolutely correct, that the Scottish and UK governments do have a very different position regards new oil and gas. That said, we are very much focused on ensuring the just transition, which is why the areas that we have responsibility for, because we don't grant licences for new oil and gas exploration, is focused on the just transition. You know, in that sense, that is where our responsibilities lie. That's where we'll continue to provide focus. But also an appreciation that those energy companies currently involved in oil and gas are themselves transitioning, and that their workforce, their investments are going to be incredibly important, reference to some of Mr Lumsden's contribution, are going to be incredibly important for us to be able to make that just transition, and that we're not going to be able to get to 2045 without private capital, and a substantial amount of that, particularly in the energy generation sphere, is going to need to come from those energy companies that are currently involved in oil and gas. So making sure that we do take a measured approach that is about appreciating the role that they have to play going forward is going to be absolutely critical, but also pushing them to go as fast as possible in that just transition is absolutely going to be of paramount importance. And that's where all of my engagements over the summer have been, and also in that sector, and also other colleagues within government, about making sure that we make that just transition happen as quickly as possible.
Thank you. I will return to the issues around public communications later on, but Cabinet Secretary, you've clarified that there is a very different position on new oil and gas between both governments. In recent weeks, you'll be aware that there's been some criticism that the Scottish Government's position has become less clear in recent times, not answering in a direct way about, you know, Government's position on Rosebank, for example, which is quite different from the position taken on Campbell. So a few days ago, the First Minister was urged to get off the fence. Not my words, but more than 100 high-profile people from the world of arts, entertainment, performers at the fringe, and members of the public asked this government to voice opposition to Rosebank, the new oil fields. I just wondered, why is the government not able to give a straight yes or no answer on that? Why is there a perception that you and your colleagues are on the fence, and do you want to get off the fence today?
Obviously, decisions around new oil and gas licensing is for the UK government. Yep. And so making sure that where there is an interest for that type of step change, that is targeted at where these decisions are getting taken, I would suggest is going to be the most effective form of campaigning. But for us, we've been very clear as I've set out, I think, to this committee the last time I came, as well as I think just about wherever I have had media at an event over the summer, that in terms of new oil and gas licensing, it's a decision for the UK government. However, we want to see much more transparent and stringent climate compatibility checkpoints. We're not opposed to any new oil and gas, but feel that it has to be passing much more stringent climate compatibility checkpoints. We'll make our position regarding the energy strategy and just transition plan clear in response to the consultations responses as quickly as we can. Obviously the language is clear in there in terms of what we are currently expecting the UK government to do on new oil and gas, and that will be clarified in response to the consultation responses in due course. But as I say, look, we've got a responsibility right now to play our part in responding to the climate emergency. We've also got to make sure that we are having a just transition. Making sure that we are taking those workers that are currently involved in oil and gas with us, because a proposition of shutting down the North Sea prematurely does not achieve a just transition. We'll see workers lost, we'll see skills lost, we'll see investment lost. It'll make it much more difficult for us to be able to reach our net zero targets and to achieve the huge renewable energy potential that we have without that investment, without those skills and workers. So we must be very careful about ensuring that we take our climate responsibility seriously, but that we don't lose those skills, people, investment that the industry currently comes with.
Mm-hmm. Before I hand back, convener, I mean, I think everyone wants a just transition. I think everyone wants to protect jobs and create good jobs. So I don't think anyone's against a just transition, but just trying to understand where something like Rosebank, which is massive in scale, where that would fit in with a just transition. Just to ask again about the Scottish Government's position, because I fully understand the decision will sit with ministers in London, but is the Scottish Government neutral on Rosebank? Do you have a view one way or the other? Or is government here happy to sit and let others go through that compatibility checkpoint and make the decision? I just wondered if in private you're having discussions that you actually are not in favour of Rosebank, because I think people would like to know.
No, we are not passive observers here. We've made very clear that for new oil and gas, we want to see much more transparent and stringent climate compatibility checks, regardless of the application or which application we're speaking about. We want to engage with the UK government on that and to see that forthcoming, because it is their decision. We do obviously attempt to engage on that basis to ensure that we are able to see that just transition in evidenced, and we'll continue to make that case, as will elements of the industry as well. They are wanting to see a much clearer, more transparent process as well, and we'll continue to work to try to achieve that with the UK government.
Okay. I think we're still on the fence, but I'll hand back to the convener.
Well, I'm totally confused. Can we have a yes or no? Do you support Rosebank or do you not?
I've made very clear that on new oil and gas, we want to see much more stringent climate compatibility checkpoints, regardless of the application that we're talking about. We have to, and I think I've made it very clear that we have to be very careful in terms of picking one application or another without having the strategy set out, without having the strategy right, whether it's for us or for the UK government, that we know we're going to rely on the oil and gas industry for some time to come. A premature closure of it sees the jobs put at risk, sees the investment potential and the knowledge and experience go with it. So we know that that is going to be of critical importance, and we also must make sure that we're taking our responsibilities to the climate and the current climate emergency seriously, which is why we must see a much faster just transition. We're working with the industry to try to push them as fast as we can on the investments that they make to ensure that they are supporting new renewable energy generation, that they are supporting the skills transition as well. And we're also looking to push the UK government to ensure that they are taking much more transparent and stringent climate compatibility checkpoints.
OK, so I think I read into that yes, no, maybe, not sure. But, I mean, I'm sorry.
No, I think it has to be...
So Mark wants to come in. I'm going to let Mark come in and then Ben, because they're queuing up to Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, thanks. We're not alone, right? So countries around the world are considering, you know, how they make a just transition away from oil and gas and do it in a way that's responsible while meeting our current and future energy needs. A lot of the conversations in that space have been around the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance. I think the previous First Minister indicated that the Scottish Government would be getting to a point where we would seek to join in that conversation at some point to be part of that Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance of countries, which include, you know, Wales and Ireland and Denmark and, you know, France and New Zealand. So I'm just wondering where things are at. I mean, in your role as Cabinet Secretary, where are those international conversations, and will we be looking again at perhaps joining BOGA at a level that's appropriate in the months to come?
Those discussions are ongoing, and that's still a proposition that's on the table. And Mr. Ruskell is right that this is not a conundrum that is facing us alone, that there are others around the world facing the very same, and we're looking to make sure that we are showing as much leadership as we can and taking responsibilities that we have, the decisions that we can take, as seriously as possible, and working, collaborating internationally to ensure that we are taking those responsibilities seriously. Obviously, we had John Kerry here recently. The First Minister introduced him for a very important speech. And other elements of discussion are ongoing on that front. And we do take those responsibilities internationally seriously. We've got world-leading targets to achieve. And so for the decisions that we can take, supporting the Just Transition Fund, supporting our energy transition, we will take those decisions and try to make sure that where those decisions are currently taken for us, that they're taken in the best way possible to ensure that we have a just transition, an accelerated just transition.
Yeah, I mean, it would be useful if we could get specific feedback on Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance and whether that's something...
I'll make sure we follow up on discussion in writing.
Yeah. That's all the questions I have right now.
Thanks, Mark. Ben, you've got some questions. The Deputy Convener, Ben, you've got some questions.
Thank you, Convener and Cabinet Secretary. I just wanted to emphasise your points about delivering a just transition. Having worked briefly in the renewable energy sector at the innovation technology development end, I can absolutely empathise with your points around the expertise that comes from the oil and gas industry that then goes into renewable development. And I think your points are well made about how, if we're broadening that out to a bigger just transition, which is, of course, the aspiration of the country as well as the government, that will take a process that will need to be done in a procedural and careful manner in order to not lose those skills. So if there's anything more you wanted to add on that, it would be interesting to hear. Also, the need to continue to grow the salaries that are available in the renewable sector so that they can compete with the oil and gas sector the way it is right now, and the tax take considerations on that. And just on Rosebank, I think your points are absolutely essential to remember here, that it will be UK government that will issue these licences, and that's where the campaigning energy for those with concerns about those issues need to be primarily directed.
So I think the Deputy Convener's point around the expertise is well made. I mean, I've been visiting a number of operations, businesses across the summer that are involved in renewable energy, and many of those people have already transitioned from oil and gas. Many of our ports are doing likewise. Obviously, the Deputy Convener has not a passing interest in this fact, but I was also at Montrose and to visit the Seagreen offshore wind farm and the substantial investments that have been made by the Montrose Port Authority in ensuring that they're capturing as much of the renewable energy potential is demonstrable. It's there for all to see, and I had a very good conversation with the Aberdeen Port Authority as well that Ms. Dunbar will be interested in, as well as Mr. Lumsden. And again, the plans that they have to ensure that they are able to scale up and have the capacity to be able to deal with what is coming from the green industrial revolution, if you want to put it that way, is huge. So we know that it's there. We know that it's coming. We just need to make sure that the landscape upon which we're operating is encouraging those investment decisions to be making, is supporting people to be making those employment decisions, and that we're making that just transition happen as fast as possible. That's this government's ambition, and I'm sure that's the ambition of colleagues around this table as well.
Thank you.
We'll move on to the next questions, which come from Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Convener, and I'm glad that you've pointed out regarding it's not just the oil and gas sector that's transitioning over, because we've actually got the fishing sector as well, and there's going to be a fair few sectors already starting to transition over if we've not already done so. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and panel. Sorry, I'll just thank you for coming along. My questions are going to be round about energy price rises. So can I ask you what, in your opinion, how challenging was it last winter for families in Scotland in terms of fuel costs? And how confident are you that there is enough support in place in Scotland, given that the fuel bills will remain high throughout this coming winter?
I thank Ms. Dunbar for that question. I cannot begin to appreciate just how difficult last winter will have been for families across Scotland. Families already struggling, but also families that will have ordinarily felt that they were relatively comfortable, found last winter incredibly difficult. And we're now in a situation to compound that where interest rate rises are posing people difficulties with mortgage payments, as well as our current situation where the new price cap is going to keep energy prices at double where they were a few years ago. So the pressure on households is still grim. And we're doing what we can with the resources that we have available to us to mitigate some of that. You know, the First Minister's first action was to see the Fuel and Security Fund not doubled but trebled. And you know, we hope that that will provide some comfort and support over this winter. But really what we need is structural change. And the sad irony is not lost on me that we're talking earlier about the massive, not just the renewable potential, but also the current energy generation that is coming from Scotland. And I saw yesterday at SSEN where that, you know, energy is, you know, four or five times beyond requirements in that particular area that I was looking at. We are generating way beyond our need, and yet we have some of the highest energy bills and highest levels of fuel poverty in Scotland. And that is why we need structural change on energy pricing. We need to see it decoupled from wholesale gas prices, and see the benefit that we have in Scotland of having the huge resource that we have actually put to use on supporting households and businesses, because you know, I was in Rutherglen yesterday, and the businesses that I was talking to, Brexit was the number one issue, but the second issue that they were talking about was energy costs, and it's been absolutely crippling, not just for households but also for businesses as well. We need to see that support continue for Ofgem and the UK government to intervene, and to see a wholesale change in the way that the market currently operates.
Okay. Some of the my constituents that have contacted me regarding bills, it's getting to the point with some of them that they're actually being charged more for their standing charges than they are actually using the fuel because they're trying to cut down as much as possible. Now, I totally get that standing charges need to be in place, you know, because it needs to help pay the background work. But also prepaid meters are way more expensive than anything else. Is there anything that we can do in Scotland to try and get things like that maybe changed for the most vulnerable folk?
I've said, Convener, I think the work that we've done with the Fuel and Security Fund to mitigate some of those pressures is important. But on both of those areas, it's a responsibility for Ofgem and the UK Government to come forward. There's obviously been quite a considerable campaign. The Scottish Government has supported this for an ending of the increased charges for prepayment meters. Welcome progress being made with colleagues, some of my colleagues at Westminster that have really led the charge on this. But we need to see more action. And actually, I think elements like that are minor mitigations, but really the structural change is what is really needing to happen to ensure that we're actually taking advantage of the resources that we've got and that we're able to put them to use for our people and to see demonstrable benefit for them in reduced energy prices.
Yeah. I mean, I've even heard of a couple of cases where there's prepaid meters, the person's gone and put in their top-up card and it's been put to zero because there was a bill outstanding from the former tenant. And I just think we need to address that as well.
I don't know if this gives Jackie Dunbar comfort or not, but I've had casework in Adrian Shots around that. I'm sure other colleagues in the committee will have had similar. And it is genuinely crippling people, but as I say, households, but also businesses. This was, we know from surveys, this is one of the top areas of concern for businesses, and particularly those that are involved in energy-intensive businesses. The first thing in terms of where your challenges are that I was asking business about, not just yesterday in Rutherglen, but throughout the summer, saying the impact that Brexit has had, but secondly, on their trading environment, but the second issue, second and third pretty close, was around energy costs and then access to labour. It is a massive issue for our entire economy. We can't afford to allow it to fester. We need to make sure that there is action coming forward. We'll continue to make that call on the UK Government and to provide greater protection for people this winter.
Okay. And I'll go to my next question. Thank you. In regards to the Fuel Poverty Act, it sets out the legal binding targets to reduce fuel poverty in each local authority within Scotland, with the first targets coming in 2030. So do you have a view on how challenging it's going to be to achieve those targets in the context of significantly higher fuel costs, as we've mentioned, and what policy will be required to address this?
I think it goes without saying how challenging it's going to be for all the reasons that I've already set out to Ms Dunbar and for the reasons that she set out in her line of questioning. We're sitting at the moment where fuel bills are double for many customers. The change in the price cap, although welcome, has had a marginal difference in fuel poverty rates. It's moved from 34% to 33% of all households. That just shows the scale of the challenge that is before us and what that shift in the energy price cap actually has done in terms of helping to alleviate the pressure on households, 34% to 33%. I think it was something like 20,000 households that actually lifted out of fuel poverty. So we need much greater structural intervention as well as mitigations to ensure that this winter isn't a very cold one for people across Scotland.
Okay. And final, my last question, convener. Whilst the green heat finances finance is changing the way that we heat our homes is primarily within the remit of the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero, we know that we need to see urgent action on heat decarbonisation. And what's your views on the delays to the Green Heat Finance Task Force report and the Heat in Buildings Bill, and what input, if any, have you had into these?
So I know that the Green Heat Task Force continues to work on bringing forward its report. I know that that is work ongoing, and their work is going to be incredibly important because, in my view, we need, as I set out earlier, on energy generation and the infrastructure that we're going to require, on ensuring that we have decarbonisation of heat networks for building users, it's going to be important that private finance is also leveraged where we possibly can. And so their expert advice on where that might be possible, the Green Heat Task Force, is going to be really important. And I very much look forward to that coming through to ensure that it informs our really important work on making sure that we decarbonise heat in homes and buildings.
Okay, and sorry, have you had any input into these? Sorry.
I have obviously an awareness of the work that's been done, and I continue to work closely with Mary McCallan, with Patrick Harvey, on the work coming forward, and continue to, I would expect to have a copy of the report when it's forthcoming, and to ensure that the stakeholders that I have an involvement with in the private sector investment landscape are able to play their part in what's going to be required in that heat and buildings work.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, convener.
Cabinet Secretary, just before we leave that, I think last year the committee looked at the budget lines that the Scottish Government had given to provide advice and support during last year's cost of living crisis and energy. What have you learnt from that, and will you be repeating the support this year, and is there a budget for it?
So obviously we'll keep that under review, and where there is a demand, we will obviously, and we have a responsibility, we'll obviously look to try to meet that demand where we can. Convener, you'll be aware of the very tight public finances, you know, that we're currently operating within. It is the most challenging public finance situation that many of my colleagues that have been in government much longer than I have ever seen. We will obviously look to make sure one of our key priorities is obviously reducing child poverty, and ensuring that we are supporting that endeavour by supporting initiatives such as you've outlined to ensure that those people facing, I think I described it grim earlier, winter going forward with heat and with energy costs in households double what they were a few years ago. We will do what we can to try to help people mitigate that as far as we can. But again, this is an area of responsibility for UK ministers and Ofgem. Not the specific interventions that you've spoken about, but the energy costs that we are facing are the responsibility of UK ministers and Ofgem to regulate. And so I would expect much greater action from them to ensure that households have been protected this winter.
Thank you. The next questions come from Monica Lennon. Monica.
Thank you. Yeah, I was dropping hints earlier on, but keen to explore your understanding of the public moods around a lot of this. So what assessment has been made of how ready the general public are for all of the changes needed to decarbonise the economy, including around renewable energy, heat and transport decarbonisation?
So I think we've all got a responsibility to play there, in all being leaders in the public discourse around what is going to be required. Obviously, government is going to be taking, we've already taken many actions. We're supporting some of our stakeholders in the actions that they take, for instance, with local government. And the action that's going to be required going forward, both in terms of, we touched on the transmission infrastructure and, you know, the understandable need for communities to have information and comfort around what that is going to mean for them, but making sure that people have an understanding of why this is all going to be necessary. There are going to be difficult things that are going to mean we all have to change our behaviours and that are going to impact all of our lives. But the challenge that we face is going to be even greater if we don't take this action. We've already seen in this summer in Hawaii, in the Greek islands, in parts of Scotland, the wildfires and the extreme weather that has been hitting parts of the world that have been had major impacts from the climate change. And so it's incumbent on us to ensure that we are taking our responsibilities seriously, but that we're also taking people with us and explaining that. And as I say, it's a responsibility of government, but it's also a responsibility on all of us. And I think some of the public debate, to be fair, mostly outside of these walls and in other institutions, has not been helpful. And I really fear that the public discourse that we get from elsewhere on the need for climate change measures, on net zero measures that are going to be uncomfortable for some people, is not helpful, and that we need much stronger leadership on the responsibilities that we all have and that we'll collectively pay as a society in order to achieve those targets that are absolutely essential that we meet.
Okay. So how do you think we can best achieve that public buy-in, that public support that we need to have?
So I was, the debate that we had on Programme for Government on Opportunity last Thursday, I was really heartened by Daniel Johnson's offer, for instance, on having a discussion around some of the energy infrastructure changes that are going to be required and some of the other net zero policies that are going to be needed. So having the discussion between parties around understanding where we stand and having a greater understanding of why we're going to be needing to take some of the decisions that we're going to need to take, and you know, having clear lines of communication and consultation on how we might be able to meet them together, I think is going to be really important. And where we can find common cause, which is why the Bute House Agreement is so important, where we can find common cause and work together, we should be doing it. So my door is open to that. I'm sure, I know that my colleagues in government door is open to respective spokespeople and others to be able to input. And for that, so that I hope the discourse that we have is on an evidence base and is taking people with us rather than seeking to divide communities, which is what I'm actually seeing coming from elsewhere at the moment.
Okay, and
Convener Ms Lennon, and also trying to deny that this is actually, in some quarters, trying to deny that this is actually an issue that we need to face up to at all. We have to face up to it. Sorry.
No, that's okay. Very helpful. And just to get into a bit more detail about what the government can do and your very clear leadership role, is there room for improvement in terms of the government's communication strategy and detailed plans around this? Mm. Are there any public information campaigns coming? Is there anything else that you can maybe point to as an example? Because I think we all accept the need for cross-party working and for all of us being responsible. But what are the communication tools that government is using?
Well, all of us have a voice, and all of us have an ability to set a very clear narrative around why that this work is important and why we cannot deny the fact that climate change isn't just something for the future, but it's happening now. Obviously, I think the work that the committee has done on ensuring that there is a greater public understanding will obviously go away and consider what we can do more, understanding that on grid infrastructure, clearly this is a UK government responsibility, but what we can do to provide as much information as we can, how we can help to work with industry on that. And obviously, you know, where there are suggestions, we would always consider them and look to do what we can to try to provide as much information as possible, but also give a greater context as to why the actions that we're going to need to take going forward, that, as I say, might be uncomfortable for some people, might change the way that we have to live our lives, are necessary. Because if we don't take this action, if we don't meet our net zero objectives, if global warming does continue to happen, then that's going to be an even greater discomfort because of the more extreme weather and the imposition that it has on people's lives and livelihoods from the impact of climate change.
Okay, and just to explore that a little bit further, because, you know, we're talking about behaviour change for individuals and organisations, but ultimately we need big radical system change for this to have any meaningful impact. So you've mentioned a few times today about your engagement with business and industry. What more should and could private companies do to communicate their plans for infrastructure investment?
I would always encourage that. And I know from the engagements that I've had in the summer that there is a lot of work going on, both in terms of the innovation that's going to be required to assist us, a huge amount of innovation happening here in Scotland, both in terms of energy generation, but also system changes that Ms Lennon references to assist us in that progress. But also they are looking themselves at what they can do in their own operations, whether they're involved in energy transition, whether they're involved in, you know, anything to do with net zero or not. You know, businesses that I deal with, you know, by and large, majority are wanting to be doing the right thing and are looking to try to decarbonise, try to make sure that they are contributing in their own way. And I think Ms Lennon's right, making sure that where we have people looking to do that, that we exemplify it, that we point it out. And that, I say we in government, but also, you know, the engagements that the committee will have with your stakeholders as well, making sure that where there has been good practice, best practice, that we are sharing that, exemplifying it and passing it forward as an example to others, and also making sure that we're pointing people in the right direction of the interventions that we're making that I was sharing with Mr Lumsden, to ensure that people know that the support is there for them to be doing this work as well.
Yeah. Well, the committee loves to shine a light on good practice and innovation. But earlier on, you did talk about the need for transparency in decision making. And I suppose for people to have the tools to combat misinformation and to identify greenwashing when they see it. So thinking again about the government's communication strategy, what more could be done to make sure that when people are given information, it is factual, it is credible, it is evidence-based, and people can be, you know, trusting of what they're hearing?
Well, it's obviously incumbent on government to be coming forward with information in the way that Ms Lennon outlines and making sure that it's credible, evidence-based, factual. It's incumbent on ministers to do that, but also making sure that the public discourse is as informed as possible as well, and also having an understanding that where... you know, for instance, in the energy sector, I think the best approach is not, you know, demonising bad behaviour, but actually exemplifying good behaviour and exemplifying where there is good work being done to transition and to ensure that they are taking the right decisions, that they are moving in the right direction, I think is the best approach, because we know that, particularly in the energy sector, as I'd said in response to Ms Lennon's earlier questions, we're going to need those people, those investments, their skills for a speedy as possible just transition. And so taking them with us, as we need to take the public with us, is going to be of critical importance.
Thank you.
Thanks, Monica. Cabinet Secretary, some questions from me now. The first one's a question of clarity. We've been trying to find out as a committee who's responsible for what. Let me see now that we've finally got the answer to our question barely last week, which we posed in June. When it comes to ferries, as I understand it, Fiona Hislop is responsible for ferry contracts, i.e. the running of them and routes. Murray McCallan is responsible for new overseas ferry bills. And Cabinet Secretary, you're responsible for Ferguson Marine and 801 and 802.
That's correct.
Perfect. So we've got the right person to ask questions on 801 and 802. Cabinet Secretary, when will 801 be in service, not when will it be handed over? When will it be in service on CalMac, with CalMac?
So obviously the Chief Executive of Ferguson Marine is due to give an update to this committee at the end of September around the costs and the timeline that has had an impact largely but not exclusively due to the MCA taking a different approach in terms of its regulation on crew escape from 801. And there's been a number of areas of change to the original design that have been required. So obviously the conversations that I have with the management at Ferguson Marine, as do my colleagues, including Vicky in the civil service, are around making sure that the ferries are delivered as quickly as possible and without any undue cost overrun, not least because our island communities need and deserve these ferries to be running as quickly as possible.
I appreciate that, Cabinet Secretary, but it was a direct question. When will it be in service with CAMAC? Now, it doesn't need David Tymon to come to this committee and tell us. You're in charge of Ferguson Marine. You must know. I'm asking you a question. When will it be in service with CAMAC?
And with due respect, Convener, I did give that answer, that Mr Tymon will be giving the committee an update. No, and that's got to be based on decisions that are still to be taken by the MCA as to whether or not the mitigations that are going to be taken on the design of the ferry are going to be appropriate for the MCA to give to pass those ferries as being safe to operate. So these are discussions that are ongoing, which is why I cannot give a date.
So he hasn't told you a date?
Well, because the discussions with the MCA are still ongoing with respect, Convener. That's why ensuring that Mr Tymon has the opportunity to be able to give the committee and myself that update on the conclusion of those, which I hope will be a positive conclusion of those discussions with the MCA, I can't give an update until those discussions are concluded. I think that's pretty clear.
I think it's really bizarre that we started with a delivery date in autumn. I understand, and we'll come to the MCA changeover with or perceived MCA changeover of regulations, that we were told autumn. Then we were told by Mr Tymon in the update that was written to us that it might be spring next year. You must have had these discussions. I'm asking you a straightforward question because islanders are asking everyone a question. And when is it going to be? And it doesn't appear you can answer me.
Well, no, because with respect, it's not just a minor thing, the MCA's decision-making on the safety of crew escapes from the ships. This is pretty fundamental to whether or not the design of the ferry allows it to sail. It's not an inconsequential matter. And so I hope, obviously, that the last update in terms of spring can be met. But until those discussions with the MCA are concluded, I cannot give any further definitive update. I think it would be unfair to suggest that the MCA's decision-making is anything other than critical to the delivery of these ferries.
So we've got to hope for spring, and we're still hoping for autumn next year for 802.
Absolutely. I'm wanting these ferries delivered as quickly as possible. I was born in an island community. I continue to have family living in an island community. I know how critical having ferries and lifeline operations are to people living in these communities and for those businesses that are operating in these communities as well. I fully understand and appreciate that. That is why we've been pushing as hard as possible for these to be built as quickly as possible. To be fair, the MCA are a regulator. It would be inappropriate for me to try to intervene on the MCA's decision making. That is for those discussions are for the Ferguson Marine and the MCA to carry out, and for those mitigations to the design of the ferries to be brought up to what the MCA is now expecting. And I hope that that can be completed as quickly as possible for all the reasons that I've already set out, Convener.
So the MCA, when they looked at the ferries, said that the requirements for the safety stairwells for crew exit weren't sufficient. You would have asked, I'm sure, as I would have asked, when the MCA or what ruling or what regulation the MCA was basing that comment on. Do you know what regulation it was and what year it came into effect?
So I'll need to reply in writing to provide full clarity on that for you, Convener. But I think it would also be appropriate for me to say it's not appropriate for me to be intervening in the decision making of the MCA nor the negotiations between Ferguson Marine and the MCA. There was a change in the application of what the MCA were expecting in terms of the crew escapes, as opposed to the previous expectation was that this would be based on cargo escape regulations as opposed to passenger. That is for the MCA to determine. I respect that process. That has meant that there is a need for changes to the design of those ferries, and the ensuring that design meets with the satisfaction of the MCA to ensure that it is safe to operate is what is currently, those discussions are currently ongoing with Ferguson Marine and the MCA, and I would support both in arriving at a conclusion as quickly as possible.
So would you accept that the MCA was brought in early enough so that there wouldn't have been this issue when it came to effect? Because my understanding is the regulations that the MCA are relying on date back to pre-2020, and therefore my problem is that nothing's changed since 2020 in those regulations. It's just that the ferries don't meet the requirements that could have been consulted on with the MCA earlier. When were they first brought in to discuss this? Was it just when you thought, or when Ferguson Marine thought it was ready to be launched?
I'll provide detail on that in writing in consultation with David Tideman, convener. My understanding is that there has been ongoing discussions on all aspects of the 801 and 802 with the MCA over a long period of time, but I'll make sure I have the full detail and clarity for you in writing.
It would be helpful if you could clarify whether this came out of the blue, was something that had never been discussed before and was not based on a regulation that predated 2020. So that would be one.
I'm not looking to point any fingers. Obviously, I am fully respectful of the fact that the MCA have a job to do in making sure that the ferries that they need to sign off are operationally safe. But I'll make sure I furnish you with the further information and do so as quickly as we can.
And so when David Tideman came to see you and said, look, there's a serious problem, we're going to have to build new stairwells, and that's quite considerable because of all the miles of cabling and pipework that I've inspected and I'm sure you've inspected, and the implications relating to that, and we could get on to all the jointing that was a problem with the previous cabling, which all had to be replaced. Did he tell you how much that was going to cost in his estimate?
So obviously part of the revised costings that Mr. Tideman provided to the committee earlier in the summer reflected that, but until there is a full conclusion over what the MCA is going to accept in terms of the final design, that's why we need to wait for that until we get the full picture. But you're right, the problems, many of the problems that we're facing are due to original design issues, and convener, if you have been around 801, you'll have had that pointed out to you as I did. We're still living with that and will do up until these ferries are signed off and handed over. Obviously, we're looking to try to ensure that Ferguson Marine are taking as much action as possible, as early as possible, with 802 to mitigate as far as is possible in learning from what has happened with 801 to ensure that the impact on 802, both in terms of cost and delivery time, is lessened, but some of that is going to be unavoidable. And that's why I continue to engage, obviously, as you'd expect, both myself and my officials on a weekly basis with Ferguson Marine and on a regular basis at ministerial level to ensure that we're delivering these ferries for our island communities as quickly as we possibly can.
And they've been waiting. Goodness knows they've been waiting, which you would accept. So it would be helpful in that letter, Cabinet Secretary, if you could itemise the cost for 801. And in fairness, that when David Tymon, I think, wrote to the committee in June, it was before this problem came to light. So I don't believe the extra additional costs that he alluded to there related to these issues that have come about from the MCA. But I suspect there will be considerable additional costs, and it would be helpful to know what those are. And it would be helpful to know if you then, on the back of those, if you'd known about those costs, whether you would have still used the ministerial direction to instruct that the costs for the ferries would still be built, despite the fact that they weren't cost-effective. Because if we'd known about those costs when you made that decision, it might have reviewed your position. And one other point, just to clarity on that, when it comes to the additional costs. What concerns me is that the costs will be considerable, because you will then have to go through the whole design structure as well, will you not, to make sure that it's fit for class, not just fit for MCA standards. Will that delay the ferries coming into service to make sure that everyone's happy with all the changes to the design, the insurers, and all the people who supplied all the equipment? Will it affect any of their warranties?
So there's a number of questions in that. I'll try and take them in turn. And first one, in terms of the authority that I gave to proceed, that was specifically in relation to 802, not 801, because 801 is close to delivery. And so there was no issue in terms of the cost there. On 802, obviously, I would have needed to consider any additional cost overrun. I continue to consider that as to whether or not it continues to be, in my view, with the wider elements that I have a responsibility to consider in terms of the local economy, in terms of those island communities having those ferries as quickly as possible. I suspect I would still have given ministerial authority, given what we know now. In terms of the points that you make around the further regulatory interactions, I know that Ferguson's continue to discuss these matters with Lloyds and continue to have an iterative sign-off process for that, and that will continue. I obviously hope that that process won't be impacted by what we're currently discussing. And in terms of the manufacturer's warranty, that's obviously matters that CalMac are responsible for in terms of and the negotiations that are there between on the warranty side between Ferguson's and CalMac, and I know that those discussions will be ongoing, and where it's required, obviously I will ensure that I am kept abreast of that and ensure that CalMac get the ferries as quickly as possible, but also in a way that meets with the contracted demands as well.
I'm just struggling in my brain, Cabinet Secretary, that it was over 4 years ago, the 16th of August, I think, 2019, that the government nationalised Ferguson Marine, and you've been in charge of it. And what I don't understand is how we're in a situation that just before the ferry is to be ready and for handover for sea trials to CalMac, that we suddenly come up with a whole list of other faults that no one knew about. I guess that if I'd been running a business for 4 years and I was in that position, somebody would ask me to consider whether I was in the right position. So I pose that. I look forward to your answers. I think they are very, very serious. And I think we need to question who knew what, because I don't believe these have come out of the blue. So I'll look forward to them. And I look forward to getting the update from Dave Tymon at the end of September, where all the costs and delivery times will be laid out for the committee in great detail, I guess, after today's meeting. Thank you. Is there any other questions from any other committees? Douglas, you want to come in.
Thank you, Convener. It was just really a point of clarity. Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned that discussions with the MCA were ongoing for some time. What do you mean? Do you mean 6 months or 6 weeks? What sort of timescale are we looking at there?
As I said to the convener, I'll make sure that there is further detail provided on those discussions, and I'll need to make sure that I consult with Mr. Tideman, who obviously has a responsibility for that interaction.
So do you know if these discussions were taking place before the last update to Parliament, which I think you gave, or was it these discussions taking place after that last update to Parliament?
I'll need to consult Mr. Tymon on the discussions that have been taking place with the MCA to ensure that I'm given an accurate reflection of what has been taking place.
So at this point, you're not aware of whether those discussions were taking place before that last update to Parliament?
In terms of the most recent issues with regards to the change of application of the rules around and the regulation around crew escape, and whether that is to be dealt with under the cargo regulations or the passenger regulations, and that specific information, I will need to consult Mr. Tymon as to when those discussions were happening.
So you weren't aware of an issue before you gave that last update to Parliament?
No.
Thank you.
Okay. I think that comes to the end of our questions, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to thank you on behalf of the committee and your team for attending here today and answering the questions. And we look forward to receiving the various correspondence that you've offered to send to the committee in relation to today's meeting. So that concludes our public meeting, and we'll now move into private session.